Rich Little is with us tonight. You all know Rich. He's an amazing man. He has a great capacity, which I envy, to do impressions, but great impressions. He not only gets the voices, but he gets the mannerisms, which takes a great deal of time. He will be opening at the Holiday House in Pittsburgh, and he's been called the Toscanini of impersonators, and I'd like to get a hold of the man who called him that. It's a lousy billing, because he's very good. Would you welcome Rich Little? You don't want to go. You don't want to go through life being billed as the Toscanini of improv. Who put that tag on you?
I don't know where that came from. I have no idea. Some critic probably put that label on me. I've seen it though. I've seen it up there on the marquee, the Toscanini of impressionists.
You know, it's funny. I was sitting home the other night, and they had a rerun on Channel 13 of one of the copycat show.
Yeah.
That you fellas did, and I was in the other room, and I hear for a moment, you know, when you stop, and I said, who? I said, I know that voice. And I was not watching television. And it was you, and you were doing a takeoff on The Tonight Show, interviewing guests.
Yeah.
You said, I heard the pencil going, yeah, and I heard
and
the...
And you heard the laugh?
The
whole thing?
And I ran in, and there you were. And it's a freaky feeling. It really is to hear somebody doing you.
It was funny doing that over in England. That's where we shot that show, in England. And the technicians and people over there didn't know half the people we were doing. You know, when we went to do you, that didn't mean anything.
The slightest idea. Why? Because
and
we don't
Ed
play
Sullivan that. Was over to do a guest shot, and I remember a technician coming up to me and saying, who's the old guy with no neck who can't talk?
They didn't know Ed Sullivan?
Didn't have a clue who Ed was.
Yeah.
I said, he's a big star.
Yeah.
What does he do? They said.
Wonder what Ed's doing now Sunday night. You think he's standing around in New York just introducing cars as they go by? It's got to be such a habit, you know.
Ed is the only man I've ever met who can count up to three and get two of the numbers wrong. which isn't easy.
The sad thought about it is there are a lot of bears standing in unemployment lines around the country waiting, you know.
He needs people to follow him around writing him day-to-day conversation. I mean, what was the bit? Oh, yeah, somebody came up to Ed Sullivan on the street, because he reads everything, and said, hello, Mr. Sullivan. Ed would probably look over their shoulder and say, don't walk.
That's a cue card, huh? He's a lovely man, and Ed Sullivan is one of the people in the business who loves people to do impressions.
I hope so.
He does. He's got a great sense of humor, because it is a compliment when somebody does you, obviously. If you're well enough known to do, you have to be flattered, unless you do a cruel impression. I've never seen you do that. But the first shot I ever did on the Ed Sullivan Show was Ed calling because I had done a takeoff on his old Toast of the Town, and that was my first big network shot was on his show.
You know, the first show I ever did with him, he gave me a great build-up. Young impersonator from Canada, fine youngster. Welcome out here, Buddy Rich.
Oh, really?
Yeah, really. Really.
You're very lucky. Ed must have been hot that night. Usually, you got one of them right. Years ago, and I've done this on a dais when we've done those Friars things for Ed. He had, and Ed doesn't mind this. It's just sometimes he forgets. And he had Rosemary Clooney on years ago. And Rosemary Clooney was just about as hot as you could get at that time. You know, everything was working, and she had all the records. Ed came out and says, now for one of America's popular, really fine singers, let's hear it. And he just went up. Come on out here, honey. She didn't even get Rosemary or Clooney. She got, come on out here, honey. And it was,
oh, I love it.
And his son-in-law, Bob Prick, you know, tells these stories. They're hysterical, but Ed doesn't mind.
He takes all these things. Really is.
If you've been watching now, you've got new fodder because of the Watergate show.
Yeah.
All of a sudden, you have seven or eight people who are relatively unknown to the general public, who now are major stars. Irvin and Talmadge and Weicker and Gurney and all of those people.
I've been watching
Talmadge
and casting it in the movies. I think Charles Laughton would have made he's no longer with us, but he would have made a great Irvin.
Yeah, you're right.
And maybe Gregory Peck to play Senator Baker.
And Ozzie Nelson is going to play Halderman. Ralph Williams going to play Erickman.
Not bad. Wouldn't that be crazy?
Oh, that's great.
That would be crazy. Erlikin reminds me of a guy who sold me some aluminum siding about 1948. uh, I don't know why. Now, have you tried to incorporate any of those voices,
oh, yeah,
or is it too
yeah.
new at all to get those down? You're
no,
very quick.
I do Baker in my accent, Senator Baker. Now, I want to go over this point just one more time, and I want to get a clear picture of what you're trying to say. Now, according to your testimony, on April the 28th, you and Mr. Halderman, Mr. Ehrlichman, and Mr. Dane went to the president's office, and at that time, the subject of Watergate came up. The president, upon hearing that, sat back in his chair and said, testing, one, two, three. Testing, one, two, three.
You know, I don't know if you've noticed this, and I'm not trying to compete with you on impression. I don't know, but your ear, you know who Gurney sounds like? He sounds like a very sleepy David Brinkley.
I was working on Gurney today, and I wrote down a little speech. Interesting sound pattern.
Oh, yeah.
Now, Mr. Dane, you mean to tell me that when you went to the president's office to discuss the events leading to and the subsequent cover-up of the Watergate incident, that you were not aware that recordings were being made?
Well, at the best of my recollection, at that point in time, I would have to say no. However, I might add that on several occasions during the course of our conversations together, the president would lead me over to a rubber tree plant and... and have me talk into one of its larger leaves.
Now, Gurney says, well, Mr. Dane, would you tell this committee your feelings toward rubber tree plants in general and the president's rubber tree plant in particular?
Well, I've never been overly fond of them, Senator.
And the other one that I was working on was Senator Montoya.
Montoya.
Isn't he the one from New Mexico?
That's right.
And,
Montoya always reminds me that he didn't hear anybody else when it comes to his turn.
That's right. He's pretty serious.
Yeah.
Did you take these tapes to your home?
Yeah, yes, I did, Senator.
Did you play these tapes on a tape recorder?
No, Senator. I played them on a washing machine.
At what speed? At what speed did you play these recordings?
Well, I believe it was. It might have been faster, Senator. I really can't recall. I think it was something like this.
Did anyone else hear these recordings when you listened to them?
To the best of my recollection, Senator, there was just the recording technician and myself listening.
The recording technician heard these tapes with you? Why is that?
Well, because I don't know how to play them on a washing machine.
Well, we'll take a quick break. We're coming right back. Back. We're talking with Rich Little. Do you remember when you were a kid, the first impression you ever did, and why you were intrigued?
Yeah,
I think all
I
kids.
I think the first voice that I ever did was Jimmy Stewart. That was the worst.
I
think maybe it could be my best. I don't know.
You do a great...
A great admiration for him, and when he did the Julie Andrews show, I spent all week talking to him, and a marvelous man and a great storyteller.
And the funny thing is, when you listen to Jimmy Stewart tell a story, you become so conscious of the voice, it sounds like a guy doing Jimmy Stewart. You know what I'm saying? I laugh because of just what he's saying.
He said, Rich, I saw you on some show singing as me. You were singing a song, and you complimented me. I said, I did? He said, yeah, when I sing in the shower... Now, remember, Stewart's not a comic, but he said, when I sing in the shower, it's so bad, the soap gets up and leaves the dish.
The dish.
Yeah. But he was the first.
Yeah. What do you do? I would assume that you must tape or record them to listen to the speech pattern, because the pattern is almost as important, you know.
Exactly.
It's probably more important. You must get the voice, the
when
tone.
When I was working on my impression of you, I played it over and over.
I'm not particularly easy to do, really. I don't believe, to impersonate.
Once you get it, you're a good subject because you have so many things that you do with the tie and the straight back and the, you know, the... All these little things. May a weird holy man put easy off in your shorts.
Yeah, I know, we all have little things. You know, you have to lay this in once in a while, Rich.
That's right.
Got to put the eye there. I don't know what... Everybody has those little... Bob Hope is a... Bob is extremely difficult to do.
And he likes to fiddle, too, doesn't he?
Bob is a... I do the pencil thing, but Bob comes on. He has three pencils. And he sits and he hits and he's one of these. Great cufflink straightener, constantly. But Bob is, voice-wise, is very difficult to do.
Very.
I've never heard anybody do Bob Hope very well.
No.
Any of the great impressionists, you or Gorshin or... No, what I meant, including any of the great impressionists.
I've never heard a good Bob Hope, and I don't know why, because he's got a distinctive sound, but nobody's been able to just to capture it very hard. Steve Allen's hard.
Outside of the laugh,
which is
your laugh.
We've
got that giggling laugh, yes, and Steve and I...
Whee! Moving right along, folks.
Okay. Is there anybody you would like to do? Who do they request most?
I would say that President Nixon is a good one to do. John Wayne has always been a popular impression.
Yeah.
And you, I mustn't...
That's funny.
You get fantastic reaction in the clubs, and of course the kids out there aren't too aware of some of the things I'm doing.
Yeah.
But it's dynamite. I do you in my act now. Doing your monologue and then bringing on Richard Nixon as your first guest.
Oh.
And
just do a little bit.
Nixon comes out. He's been working with Bob Hope for 2 weeks. And I say, my first guest is Mr. Richard Milhouse Nixon. You remember him? No. Well, we forget so soon. No. For the past couple of weeks, Mr. Nixon's been working with Bob Hope, and Bob's been helping the president with his. See how I goof like you? that little trip, that took 2 weeks to get that. No, he's been working with Bob Hope for the past couple of weeks, and here is the brand new president of the United States after only 2 weeks' work with Mr. Bob Hope. And then I come out, Nixon comes out.
This is Richard. How I love to be President Nixon. I want to tell you. You know, my fellow Americans, I just got back from Hollywood, where I was working on a new motion picture. It's called Planet of the Tapes. But I want to tell you, Spiro Agnew was going to write the screenplay, but unfortunately, he could never find his damn crayons. But I want to tell you...
And that just goes on. Oh, yes. I love this bit.
But you do a pretty good impression of Tommy Newsom.
You do Newsom, boy. You go ahead.
Tommy Newsom's talking to each other, all right?
Hmm? Okay. No, you gotta do it. Okay. You gotta do 30 seconds of Bogart doing the thing about the strawberries.
Well, has he ever done that?
No,
ever?
No, I never have, and I'm not going to do it anymore.
There was a time about a year ago, every night he was going to do that bit, and I kept tuning in.
Well, I would see you do it on a show, and I said, I'm not even going to get near it, as long as Little is still doing the bit.
I tried to run this ship properly, but they fought me at every turn. They were all against me. I take the broken tow line, defective equipment, no more, no less. But they encouraged the crew to scoff at me and to circulate wild stories. I was to blame for Mr. Merrick's poor seamanship and incompetence. But the strawberries. I asked for the strawberries. They laughed at me, but I proved beyond a shadow of a doubt and with geometric logic and deduction that a duplicate key to the wardroom icebox did exist. And I'd have produced that key if they hadn't pulled the cane out of action. Mr. Merrick was the perfect officer, but not Captain Queek. But I have the strawberries. They laughed at me, but I proved beyond a shadow of a doubt and with geometric logic and deduction that a duplicate key to the wardroom icebox did exist. And I'd have produced that key. Naturally, I could only recall these things from memory. If you ask me specific questions, I'll tackle them one by one.
Oh, that's great.
That's why I don't do it. Now you just...
Oh, get out of here. That's why.
John, could you do the same speech as Porky Pig?
That's all, folks.
All right. We'll return with our guest after we take a pause for this message.
Burton had the looks, the charisma, and that fantastic voice. But in the eyes of some, he sacrificed his artistic promise by becoming a huge Hollywood star. He was permanently plastered across the newspaper front pages, and more famous for his lifestyle and relationship with Elizabeth Taylor than for his roles and his talent. It was a criticism Burton didn't necessarily reject. In interviews throughout his career, he would openly admit that he was driven by money, and that he didn't rate many of his own performances, downplaying perhaps his 7 Oscar nominations for Best Actor. We join Burton here for an interview with Michael Elwyn from the 1965 program My Time Again, which begins with him discussing the craft of acting.
How absorbed into a part do you get? I mean, you seem to use little theatrical tricksiness. It is very much your own brooding personality and voice with little technical means of getting something over. How much, you know, do you feel in a part?
Well, I didn't think that I was capable of, I don't know quite what the word is, but when you get close to a part, in my case, it's a sort of osmosis, the transference of something from one thing to the other, that I actually begin to feel curiously like the character that I'm playing, even if it's in a film. And I'm not by any means a method actor. I don't deliberately think myself into these kind of things. But there is an odd thing that does happen, I think, when you're totally absorbed in a part.
Yes.
I'm a fairly gray fellow, latterly very gray, and live within myself as to a... Because I'm playing a part who is gray and lives within himself, is not heroic, anti-heroic. I wouldn't accept a fight from anybody at the moment, though maybe a year ago I would have.
You made your name playing Hamlet, Henry V, Iago, Coriolanus, roles like these, and never Troilus, Florizel, Romeo. How
I hate
alien?
Those parts.
It's completely alien, is it? Sort of the open expression of emotion.
I think Romeo is probably the worst part ever written by anybody that's so famous, I mean.
Mm.
There are worse parts. I once played Ferdinand in The Tempest. I tell you a story about when you start to get the bad notices. It's interesting to collect them. My favorite bad notes in the world is for Ferdinand in The Tempest, who's a kind of stand-in, a kind of understudy for Romeo and all those abject Shakespearean heroes who are quite clearly are ladies. And I was playing this part, Ferdinand in The Tempest, and I loathed it with a passionate intensity, and I begged them to let me out of it. I said, I'll be one of the dancers, I'll be a nymph, anything. I said, but don't let me play this dreadful, diabolical Ferdinand. However, they forced me to play it, and I'm not short, but then I'm not tall either. I'm exactly 5 feet 10½ inches in height, and I tend to width. They put me in a costume that had bunches of grapes over here, you know, so that I looked like some strange Welsh Stone Age troglodyte. And I pretended that I wasn't on the stage. And I had a little toy sword in my hand, and those terrible things they give you in Shakespearean clothes that make your legs look about 2 inches high. And I was perfectly convinced that nobody knew I was on the stage. And indeed, the critics were suitably kind. They all said I contributed effectively to the atmosphere or something like that, except for an old friend of mine called Ken Tynan, who said, this is the first time in our experience that we've ever seen Ferdinand played by a bull.
You moved on from the English theatre to Hollywood when you were, well, as many people have said, on the threshold of greatness in the English theatre. Did you leave for financial reasons, or has the cinema always held a stronger fascination for you than the live theatre?
No, not particularly, no. I went to Hollywood and I made a couple of films, both of which were very successful. One was called My Cousin Rachel and the other was called The Robe. And then I, if you call about the threshold, I was on the threshold then of earning, I suppose, a great deal of money. And I was very sensible, I thought, and went back to the Old Vic and played for a year at the Old Vic and therefore got into debt. Mm. I played Hamlet and Coriolanus and The Bastard in King John and Caliban and I've forgotten what all. And then I went back to Hollywood again, did another film, then went back to the Old Vic for another year. And I spread it out fairly evenly between the two worlds. Greatness is a word I don't understand.
I asked the question because you seem to have spent a long time in cinema trying to come to grips with the camera, and critical success has eluded you until recently in Beckett and Night of the Iguana.
Yeah, well, the reason for that is over there. It's my wife, you know. She knows a great deal about film acting, and she persuaded me that I mustn't pretend that film acting is just a means of filling in time between stage performances. Yeah. And indeed, made me work at it, which I never done. I think, fundamentally, profoundly believed that film acting was only an excuse for acting until, as you very kindly pointed out latterly, you know, the last 3 or 4 years.
You feel you're now beginning to feel at home.
Yeah, well, I wouldn't go so far as to think that I'm good or anything like that in the film half of the business, but certainly I try much harder than I did.
Do you film more because basically you're Byronic and the location work and the traveling and the unreal atmosphere is just as, makes just as big a contribution to your own personal happiness as does the actual creating of a role?
Yeah, that's a dicey question. Byronic is such an extraordinary word to apply.
I
don't like traveling
very
much.
Around the world, you don't?
Yeah, no, I like being in places. I hate getting there. I hate planes. I don't mind trains, and I don't mind boats. But nowadays one has to fly everywhere, so I hate getting from one place to the other. Also, we have an enormous family, and traveling from one place to the other with 4 children is not easy. No, that has nothing to do, I don't think, with the film business, my desire to travel or my lack of desire. It's just that one has to.
If I could change tack, how important is the literature of theatre to you?
Immensely important, much more important than anything else, I think.
What do you read and who and...?
I don't read plays very much. Mm. I don't like plays to read, except, of course, Shakespeare. My chief world, I suppose, as a reader is almost entirely poetic, or the opposite, detective stories. I'm a voracious reader, omnivorous, I will read anything. But the thing that draws me back all the time is poetry. I'm not really interested in Brecht or any of the non-poetic writers. People who are quite clearly instinctively poetic, like John Osborne or Harold Pinter, who, despite the fact that they write in prose, are unquestionably poets, are fascinating. Or like the man that I'm going to play next, that I never played, Edward Albee, though he writes in prose, there's no question about this man's stupendous eloquence and poetry. But to play some of those chaps who write sort of Lonsdale comedies or anything like that never interested me at all.
If you wrote a play, would it be in verse or?
If I wrote a play, it would be a monologue, and I would play the central part.
Do you have any plans to return soon to the live theatre in England? I know you've done Hamlet recently on Broadway, but this was your first return to classical roles for a long time. Are we going to?
Yes, I think next year I go back to Oxford, to our university, and play Faustus, Mahler's Faustus, with Dr. Neville Coghill directing. And the rest of the company, apart from Helen of Troy, who shall be nameless, will be played by the boys at Oxford.
That performance of Dr. Faustus did go ahead, with Burton and Elizabeth Taylor waiving any salaries, and Taylor taking the non-speaking part of Helen of Troy. The pair of them also faced some prickly prodding from the press once the production had ended.
You must at some time, Richard Burton, have faced the question of whether you should have continued as an imposing, and even in the view of many people, great stage actor, or moved into the world of films, which is more commercially rewarding, but perhaps not so rewarding artistically. Do you ever regret having moved into the commercial cinema?
Oh, excuse me, Richard, that makes me so angry. Because he has not left the stage. That's absolute bloody rubbish. Well, last year, he just got through doing a thing here for Oxford on the stage. The year before that, what was he doing on Broadway? That was the stage. How can you say he's left the stage?
Because that is not a continuous stage career in the sense that, for example, Paul Schofield or Laurence Olivier.
He's not continuous either on the stage. He does film appearances for money.
This is the
first. And so does Paul Schofield.
But Schofield has made one film in 10 or 14 years. And Richard was at one time, after Coriolanus particularly, hailed as being potentially the greatest stage actor that England ever produced. I wonder whether in a way your making of Faustus, which is the story of a man who sells out for a dream almost, is perhaps comparable with your decision then.
No, I don't think so, because one of the differences I think between myself and some other actors is the fact that they really have almost an anguish. For instance, Sir John Giegold is almost my favorite actor in the world, and I think most of us. John really is helpless. He's upset unless he gets onto the stage and gets his teeth into a part, even though it's a part perhaps he doesn't want to play. He just has to be there. I don't have that sense of compulsion. Also, I need roughly about 6 weeks of active playing after the rehearsals, after you've opened, before the part matures as fully as I can make it, and then it begins to crack and flaw. I don't have, I have enormous energy, but I don't have that kind of moral stamina that Laurence Olivier has and Paul has and John has to go on and on, you know.
I wanted to ask Elizabeth Taylor if your irritation then was because you felt that the cinema was not the creative medium that the theatre was.
Like
I didn't know why you got so cross.
Because you said the exact phrase that I knew you were working up to, sold out, and it offends me to my soul. I'm going to sell out, I hope one day, to the stage. It's exactly the same thing. If I go on the stage, I'm selling out.
You mean you feel that the two arts are, in their own mediums,
of
just as comparable?
They are.
Quite. So you reckon that Richard Burton's cinema performance is as creative as anything that he could have done on the stage?
It's just as tasking, perhaps sometimes more tasking, because it's more difficult.
Well, I don't know about that.
Technically,
but
I mean,
also
you have
I
to
think
start
David,
into a scene
that,
where you have a flow, and you stop for 2 hours, and then you start again. I promise you, your concentration has to be really finely whittled down.
But anyway, David, I think that usually that sold-out business is written in England. Now,
the chief journalist.
Now, I left England in 1957, so the last play I did was in 1957. Since that time, I've done 6 plays, 5 of which were enormous successes in New York. But since you've disappeared from the London scene, they sometimes tend to think that you're not still acting on the stage, you know. And I don't care whether they think I've sold out or not. I know whether I've sold out or not.
One thing you have said, Richard, about your life with Elizabeth Taylor is that it is a continuous excitement. but one can never really be sure what he's going to do next, as I found out just now. would you say that the excitement will continue?
No, we enjoy each other's company very much, and we people of very high temperament, as you know, as you may have noticed from Elizabeth.
Indeed, yes.
And we find it very difficult to be apart from each other for more than 2-3 hours. And in fact, our film careers are absolutely, film and stage, absolutely bound up with the fact that we must never, ever be separated.
You don't mind being known as the Laurel and Hardy?
Now, I'm naming me that.
And I said, what's wrong?
What's wrong?
We should be so lucky.
Do you ever wish you weren't so beautiful? You were not born so beautiful?
Oh, God, I just wake up every morning saying, Jesus, if only I weren't so gorgeous. What do you mean?
Well, you are. You are. You are.
Yes, she said, what do you mean? Of course, I wish you wasn't beautiful.
No, but sometimes a woman does. Sometimes a woman who is an actress says, God, if I weren't, then, you know, they'd take me more seriously, as Richard is saying.
One said of those mythical, apocryphal actresses who jump into a bath of milk every morning and splash themselves, I am beautiful, I am beautiful, I am beautiful. Elizabeth doesn't do that, a bath of gin.
Do you ever...
Richard Burton's marriage to Elizabeth Taylor would last into the next decade, but by 1974, the years of high living and hard drinking had taken their toll, as Barry Norman explored in an interview on the set of Burton's latest film, The Voyage.
Over the past 10 years, Burton has probably become as famous for his flamboyant purchases of yachts and aeroplanes and fur coats and fabulous diamonds as for his acting. The Burton-Taylor marriage, as far as one can ever tell with such a volatile couple, is now over, but it was certainly exciting while it lasted. Quarrels, reconciliations, and the frequent exchange of lavish presents. And always on Burton, there was the dominating influence of his wife.
Richard, looking back on your career, it seems to be divided in two, almost exactly by Cleopatra. Would you agree with that, that it changed course completely after Cleopatra?
Well, I don't know. I think my life was changed by a woman, you know, who's called Elizabeth Taylor. I'm not entirely sure what exactly she did to me, but certainly I don't know exactly what to say, but those people, you know, like Laurence Olivier and Paul Scofield and Marlon Brando and Elizabeth Taylor and people like that, they're very rare, very strange, very odd, very perverse, and they obviously believe that they are very extraordinary people in their odd way, and they believe firmly, of course, that that they are gifted by God or something like that. Unfortunately, I don't believe that, you see. I mean, about myself. There is unquestionably a kind of passion, a strange idiocy, where you walk on the stage or you walk on the screen or whatever it is, and you feel a strange kind of power. I defy the power, of course.
What would you say it is that you do when you're up there in front of the camera?
No, I think I'm a sort of animal. I get on there and I dutter out the words and I have a reasonable voice and so on, and I just get up there and become an animal in some strange way, in the same way that the other people become animals, except that they believe that they are fundamentally powerful and beautiful and so on. I don't believe that at all. Certainly I'm not powerful, certainly I'm not beautiful, but I don't understand what these fellows do, except that I appreciate what they do, if you know what I mean.
But then what keeps you going in the same profession?
Money.
But you don't need the money now, surely?
You've got to be joking. I've got about 50,000 people to take care of. I have to pay everybody off, I have to pay lawyers, legends. I'd keep this dog, you know. At the moment, I'm doing all right. I pick up a lot of money for films, and I don't know. I don't know. And it's absolute nonsense. The whole idea of the film business is nonsense. On the stage, of course, I'm absolutely sure, I'm certain I can go anywhere and play anything. But I don't really know what prompts the imagination of the public. It's a funny Chinese dog, the only Chinese dog who speaks Welsh. No, I really think it's very odd and very perverse. Laurence Olivier once said that were it not for the fact that he were an actor, he would have gone mad. And I'm beginning to think that I would have gone mad too. But I don't put myself in the same, of course, category as Laurence Olivier, because he really loves the theatre. He's obsessed by it and so on. I'm not.
On what basis now do you choose the roles you're going to play in movies? Because sometimes you seem to make very curious choices. Films like Bluebeard, for instance, and Hammersmith is out. One wonders why you chose to do those films.
Yeah, I long to be a failure.
And?
And I am a failure.
Well, yeah, but a very successful failure.
No, and I managed to get along. I'm afraid that in about 5 or 6 months, I'm going to go back on the stage. It terrifies me, it appalls me, but I'll go back on the stage.
Why? I mean, is it sheer masochism?
Perhaps. Never thought of that.
Richard, where do you go from here? I mean, how do you envisage your future? Are you going to go back to the stage? Are you going to continue making movies? You once told me you were going to retire.
I think that the essential thing that I must do is quietly room myself into the grave, you know, sleep. Sleep is so fundamental. Did I ever tell you that poem about sleep? I bet I didn't.
No, I don't think you did. But is it going to be back to the theatre or more movies?
No. The only thing that's important are the children and Elizabeth and being alive, I suppose, in a sort of extraordinary way. I don't know. I really don't know.
That sounds a very depressed attitude for you to be taking. I would have thought that in the position you're in now, you would be feeling much more bucked up about things.
You know, you must understand, Barry, that I'm sending you up.
I thought you might be.
Yeah. I think I'm reasonably intelligent, clever, good, kind, sweet, nasty.
Gifted?
Oh, no. I'm not a gifted.
But do you feel very vulnerable then when you're acting?
I hate acting.
Well, you did tell me a few years ago that you were planning to give it up. But you're still doing it. You've made a lot of films since then.
I have to make the money, look. I have to make the money. You know, if you give your wife a jewel or something like that, costing him, shall we say, about $100,000 or whatever it is. What the hell are you going to do, you know?
No. I just count the shekels and I count the money.
Do you really do it just for the money, though, Richard?
Now, Barry,
I mean, you're
in a very, very, very strange state. Who knows what happens? I don't know. May I have a cigarette?
By all means, yes. Do you enjoy this superstar status, the tremendous celebrity, the fact that you can't move without being mobbed? Do you really enjoy it, that kind of life?
If it stops, I'm dead.
Just 2 months later, Burton was divorced and had just spent 6 weeks in hospital battling his legendary alcoholism. Coming back would eventually mean three more weddings. One, a short-lived reunion with Elizabeth Taylor, and then to Susan Hunt, and finally to Sally Hay. Coming back also meant some notable career successes. Equus earned Burton rave reviews on the stage, and his role in the movie version that followed won him a Golden Globe. He narrated the smash hit that was Jeff Wayne's War of the Worlds and scored a huge box office hit with the film The Wild Geese. In fact, in spite of his health problems, he found it impossible to stop working, as he explained in a documentary in 1983.
Once Elizabeth said, it'd be a very good idea if you took a year off, because you never stop. Because she's only done 30-something films, 35 films, and she's been a star since she was 8. And, but she takes time off. I never have. I've done the most utter rubbish in order to have somewhere to go in the morning. So she said, take a year off. So I said, okay, we had a lovely house in Mexico, sunny, everything. I lasted 5 weeks. I was off. I did a film. I won't bother to tell you about it.
Oh, come on.
No, a man came to see me and he said, you know, we got a lot of wastage on the floor of a film called Tobruk. I said, oh, have you? He said, it made $6 million. And I said, did it? I said, who's in it? He said, Rock Hudson and George Pippard. And he said, I picked up all these bits off the floor and I put them all together. And I got all the writers in, Universal Studios. Universal Studios is still run like the old studios was, with a big boss and all that. So I said to the 10 writers, you know, make a script so that we can use the long shots and use Burton in the close-ups. And they did it. And they made a doable film. And I was so fascinated, I couldn't resist it. And we went off and we shot the film in, I don't know, 3 weeks and 2 days or something. And the film went out and was successful. It's called Raid on Rommel. And all the long shots, it's Rock Hudson. And all the close-ups, it's an Englishman called Green. And all the long shots, it's George Pippard. And all the close-ups, it's me. 1 year, I earned $8 million for one film. I got paid $1 million for the film, and the film was so successful that another $7 million came in. I remember getting a check just before Christmas, about 3 days before Christmas, for $1 million, which added to the rest. And it's not that I'm frightened of the money or anything like that. It's not my profits. I give it away. Give it to my family, or I buy enormous presents for Elizabeth Taylor, or did, or for Susan, or for Sally, who's the next one up. I cannot hold on to it. Mm. I hold on to a little piece of property with a roof on the house, and that's all.
What's the worst film you've made?
I don't know. I made some lousy ones in my time. See, I always start off, usually, not that one, with very good intentions. You know, the script seems very good. The director has a tremendous reputation. The producer is a good producer. And you start off and you suddenly realize after 2 weeks you're in a piece of rubbish. And there's nothing you can do about it. Now, in a play,
oddly enough, I've done almost exactly the same number of plays as I've done of films. In a play, I've only had one really real failure, which was in New York. I mean, we only ran for 2 weeks or something like that. And a good play, too, by Ennui. But I think it was misdirected and miscast, and I don't think I was very good, all that. But whether that is the fact that you yourself can change a play without benefit of director, as long as you've got a good lighting man and who can light the damn thing properly, and good actors around you, you can actually do things with an indifferent piece, which you can't do with the film. Well, you know, I've never thought much of myself as an actor. And I don't mean to be modest. But, at the same time, I don't think there's been any particular successful thing that I've ever done, that one particular one that gave me any special pleasure. I think the fact that I was able to take care of a certain amount of people has given me some pleasure. The fact that I had the power to do it. But then there are some people, maybe three or four in the world, I mean outside my family, whom I love. You know, I trust them with my life. And I've had to sometimes. And all the things, all the troubles that they've gone through, you can imagine, as a result of the enormous publicity that I've had in my life. And never once have they ever worried me about it, or said, hey, stop doing this, or stop doing that, or you're being a bad boy, or anything like that. They've been terribly good with me, always. They're a marvelous family. And apart from my family and two, three other people, very few people I would trust with anything.
This was Richard Burton's last interview for the BBC. His final role, for which he was critically acclaimed, was as the menacing O'Brien in the movie of George Orwell's 1984, in which he co-starred with John Hurt. 2 months before the film premiere, Burton suffered a brain hemorrhage and died at home in Switzerland. He was 58. In the obituaries, one of the most quoted anecdotes was his response to a telegram he once received from Sir Laurence Olivier that said, "Make up your mind, dear heart. Do you want to be a great actor or a household word?" Burton's answer was immediate. He simply said, "Both."